strangely strange, but oddly normal.
Hi, I'm Charlotte Phillipson, and welcome to another episode of, what's it called?
On the Track.
On the Track.
This month, my co-presenter is a charming young lady called Charlotte. Well, yes, you've already met her, but who is she? Well, therein lies the tale. About 6 weeks ago, I got a text message from a guy called Steve Ryder. We had quite a few friends in common. He'd just moved to the village. Could he come down and see me, he said. Yes, of course, said I. We ended up having a jolly evening, which lasted until about 3 a.m, and the next day he brought along his wife, Andrea. Well, Andrew's a sweetie, and by various machinations ended up being my secretary. And one evening, Andrea came over with a young lady called Charlotte. Is this your daughter? I asked. No, she said. She's the daughter of some friends of mine who live in the village, who go to the same school as my daughter, and she wants to be a naturalist when she grows up. Charlotte and I got talking, and it was clear that we are kindred spirits. I don't know if that means that I'm functioning at a 12-year-old level or she's functioning at a 55-year-old hippie level, but it seems to work. And she comes here and does all sorts of stuff with us on Saturday afternoons. She's a charming young lady, and when she grows up, she wants to be a TV naturalist. So I said, as I do, a monthly webTV show, why doesn't she come along and try and get involved with that? So she has. Here she is, and On the Track is never going to be the same again. This month, however, we have somewhat of a gastropod theme. So, Charlotte, what's a gastropod?
A gastropod is the largest group of mollusks, including all slugs and snails.
So what are you doing, Karina?
Trying to open this bag.
Do we know what's in the bag?
We don't know for sure, but I think it's snails. Feels like it could be.
Do we know what species of snail?
I don't know. Apple snails.
What have we got?
Yes, there is. You can see in there a snail.
Okay, let's have a look. What have we got here?
Is that it?
No, that's the eggs. This is some eggs of Colombian giant ram's horn snails.
Marisa cornuaratus is the largest species of freshwater snail. It's widespread in northern South America, although the type locality is unknown. In recent years, it's become established in certain parts of the southern USA. Something particularly interesting about this species is that they're not ram's horn snails at all. They just look like them. It's an example of convergent evolution, whereby a creature that's really part of the apple snail family has assumed the shape of much better known ram's horn snails, which are found all over the world, including the United Kingdom. I've always been fascinated by convergent evolution, the way that different animals that are completely unrelated to each other do evolve to fill the same ecological niche and end up looking like each other. What the evolutionary advantage of having a spiral shell like a ram's horn snail or like these delightful little fellows is, I don't know. I'd love to find out. Anybody out there able to tell me? However, our new babies are tiny. Four of them seem to have hatched during the journey from their original home somewhere in the north of England down to us. And we also have a big clump of eggs looking like tiny frog spawn, which I hope will hatch in the next week or so.
You didn't buy one lot of snails, though. There's more, isn't there?
There most certainly is, Charlotte. This is a Tylomelania snail, an absolutely beautiful species which comes from a small lake system in Sulawesi, what in my day was called the Celebes, part of Indonesia. There are 30-something species of Tylomelania snail, of which 15 of them have been discovered since 2003, including this one. It appears that they are all restricted to the Lake Poso area and to the Malali Lake system, consisting of Matana and Tawuti, and two much smaller lake systems in the island. They're found nowhere else in the world, and I think they're utterly gorgeous. Like all snails, they are hermaphroditic, and I hope the fact that I have two of them here in a tank on my desktop is going to encourage them to breed. I don't mean that the sight of me looking at them every morning is going to encourage them to breed, but I hope the fact that there are two of them in a tank which seems to be the optimum conditions for them, and where the only predators are too small to be able to eat them, means that we may well have the pitter-patter of tiny snails soon. I certainly hope so. This is one of the most gorgeous gastropods that I have ever seen, and some of the other ones in the family are equally as beautiful. I wrote about these in one of my blogs this week, and somebody wrote back asking me whether I wasn't in contravention of CITES or some other international agreement for protected species. Well, as far as I'm aware, none of these things are protected. I bought them perfectly legally over eBay, of all places. And whilst I have been known to bend the law to my own wishes at times in the past, I'm not stupid enough to then brag about it on YouTube. No, these snails, as obscure and as restricted as they are, were bought perfectly legally, and I'm keeping them perfectly legally, and I very much hope that I will be able to disperse some of their offspring as well.
But there's more. What's Riley doing?
I think there were two in that one, and a couple. I can't remember how many I actually bought. I know I bought two big ones. They're cute, aren't they?
I think that I remember telling you last month about a piece of absurd governmental idiocy, which means that apple snails are no longer able to be imported into the EU.
That is pretty impressive, isn't it?
Where is it going in this one?
Yeah, just put them in there. How many are in that box?
I don't know.
Sorry?
Well, I looked at two.
Yeah, that's okay.
So I decided unilaterally that the CFZs are going to have a go at breeding some.
I'm getting old and my memory's failing, I don't remember.
Originally from South America, this is a species which unfortunately has become established in parts of Spain, leading to an EU-wide ban.
Brilliant. Nice healthy ones. Okay, if you just put the other ones in as well. Oh, brilliant. Thanks, mate.
I hope that our breeding program, both with the apple snails and our other two new species, are successful. But now I've also got some good news for you. The government have caved in. Yes, the government have caved in over the matter of the very controversial badger cull. Now, I'm in a bit of a quandary here. Do I cheer on the fact that the government have seen sense, or mock them for caving into public pressure? Well, as I was one of the people who gave the public pressure in the first place, I can hardly do that. Anyway, it would have made a nonsense of all this. I'll never be seen as a statesman, and I'll never make this nation great, man. And I really don't know what to do now, they won't let me go to war.
Done to public confidence by Iraq.
Yes, just in case you didn't know, Simon Jester was me all along, and the guy dressed up as the Prime Minister and dancing with the two puppet badgers was Graham. Yes, it was another CFZ piece of silliness. But in my book, sometimes being silly is the best way to make a political point. What do you think, Charlotte?
I think you're all very silly, but not as silly as the government.
But there's more. There's much more.
So what else has happened?
The government have also done a big backpedal on plans to reintroduce fox hunting through the back door. Under the pretext of doing something to help beleaguered Welsh hill farmers, the government had been planning to relax the laws on hunting with hounds. This, of course, would have managed to make people who enjoy killing foxes all over the country have a field day, or rather have a field sports day. Ha ha! But again, the government caved in the face of public opposition, and the plans were shelved. Whilst on the subject of fox hunting, I'm very proud of one of my nieces, who shall remain nameless, but she dumped her long-term boyfriend recently when she found out that he was involved in semi-legal fox hunting.
if more pretty girls got rid of their oafish boyfriends because they were animal abusers, I think the human race would pretty soon stop abusing animals. Come on, girls, what do you think? What I'm suggesting is, of course, not a new political stratagem. Aristophanes wrote about it about 400 years before the birth of Christ. But it worked then, and I bet it would work now. But I think Charlotte has a question for me.
What's Andrea doing?
I don't know. She'll be embarrassed her by pointing the camera at her and asking her. You ask her.
Andrea, what are you doing?
I am editing a book.
What book?
Called Mysterious Creatures, A Guide to Cryptozoology, by George M. Eberhardt.
At the 2012 Weird Weekend, all the money raised went to an American company called ABC Clio, who back in 2002 released this, a two-volume encyclopedia of cryptozoology by George M. Eberhardt. It is a fantastic book, but the only problem with it was that the first edition was incredibly expensive, something like £180 for two books.
How much?
And we decided that, especially as the books had been out of print for ages, that it'd be a damn good idea if we went out and published our own edition. So we bought the rights. As I may have mentioned once or twice, I'm an avowed anti-capitalist, and I come from the generation that used to have stenciled on the corner of their punk record, pay no more than 99p. Well, we're charging a bit more than 99p, we're charging £14.99 a volume, in fact, to be precise, but a shade under 30 quid is still a hell of a lot better than 170, isn't it, Charlotte? Andrea, my delightful newly discovered friend and secretary, without whom I think the CFZ office would fall apart in a matter of moments, is working very hard on the project. Poor girl, this is the second time she's had to do it, because she managed to get it all finished by the beginning of last week, and then I managed, by being an idiot, to delete it all. Volume 1 was released for last year's Weird Weekend, and Volume 2 will be out directly, as they say in North Devon. Charlotte's been very busy here over the last few weeks.
I've been helping Saskia refurbish the conservatory. She's doing it as part of her college project. And she, her brother Riley and I, together with Sherry, the other intern, were painting the conservatory yellow. According to John, it hasn't been done for 30 years. The quail usually live outside in the aviary, but they come from Japan and it's been quite a cold spring. So they are still indoors in their winter quarters. And as their winter quarters are on the floor of the conservatory, we had to make sure we didn't get paint on them. Another job of ours was to give the cockroaches a nice new home. They've been living in a plastic box for a couple of years now. And they've been taking up a lot of room in John's study. The museum needs a new roof, so quite a lot of the animals and other things that would have stayed in the museum are coming down to the conservatory for the rest of the year. It all depends on the weather though. If the weather's fine, and we manage to fix the roof in time, then it's possible the museum will be ready for visitors, in time for the Weird Weekend.
One of the best ways of getting rid of excess nitrates and nitrites in your fish tanks is to use Japanese moss balls. I always think they look rather attractive as well, and find myself humming the relevant track from David Bowie's Heroes under my breath as I look at them. The other morning we had some delivered in the post. Yeah?
Soft and squashy.
Say that again.
Soft and squashy.
Poor Karina finds herself unpacking all sorts of strange things in the mornings.
Isn't it exciting?
Yes, it's the best Christmas, isn't it? So do you know what these are?
I don't know what they are. John seems to think they are calcium blocks.
Calcium blocks, of course, go in the water to enrich the shells of the snails and our old friend Lobby the Lobster. But that is an entirely different story, because now we go to Bradworthy and the Penbode Veterinary Surgery and a poor abused lizard. Helen Taylor is our old friend and housekeeper, and like us, she does a lot of animal rescue. This next story is actually something which is almost my fault, because it was me who told Helen that there was somebody who wanted to rehome an iguana, and Helen has always wanted an iguana. What neither of us knew until she took custody of the creature was that at least one of its previous owners hadn't looked after it very well. It had a necrotic end to its tail,
which basically in layman's terms means it was rotting and falling off. I feel terribly guilty here because it was me, through one of my nephews, who got hold of this iguana for Helen, and it's cost her something in the region of 200 quid already.
Tissue looked really fresh and good. And I think we should see if this will regrow on its own.
So
if you carry on with your iodine...
I will.
And I'll give him his final jab today.
Okay, because all the thing that Kate was worried about, whether there was a tiny bit left of the flesh left behind, whether it would flare up again.
Yes.
She didn't know whether to go ahead and just cut a tiny bit off anyway. I said I'd talk to you about it, but it did look nice and clean when...
The thing is, if... From what Richard Hazard says, if we were to take the tail off, we would literally just break it off.
Yeah.
And pull it.
Mm.
From what, I mean, it's a bit darker now. It's a bit darker now than, you know, obviously when the first bit came off.
Yeah.
When it actually came off, it was nice and pink.
Yeah, it was.
There was no dark
pink.
bit there.
No.
So I think if we took it further off, further up, this, it would still look like this over a few days.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
And if it doesn't regrow, we've always got the choice. We can do it then.
Yeah. Well, we'll have a look.
That's what I'm inclined to say.
Trying to get this off, because this is the toughest bit, the last bit he's got to come off.
Yeah.
It's his skin.
Okay, let's give him his jab.
Jackie, the vet, has been working with him.
I'll go for this leg.
Right, I'll... All right, sweetie.
Yes, good chap. You've got tough skin, haven't you? There we go.
Lovely. I've been doing it every day.
Good.
All right.
No, because the iodine will make it go darker.
Because Kate was asking me how big, but it's really hard to explain.
What, how big the bit that came off?
The bit
off
that
was.
Came off, and I said, but.
It was less than. It was a couple of centimetres, wasn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
But it had shriveled up. You know?
Yeah.
And there was no bone exposed or anything like that afterwards. You know,
no.
I could see. I could, it just looked
nice. Cross again to the tail. X ray to check there's no infection going up the tail. Discharge from the end of the tail, and we took a swab, didn't we?
Yeah.
I took advice from Richard Hazard of Veterinary Hospital in Plymouth.
He's a reptile vet,
yes,
isn't he?
Advice from Richard Hazard, and he was really good. So, a swab taken. Discharge from the end of the tail, advice from Richard Hazard of Veterinary Hospital Plymouth, and then injected every 72 hours with ...20 milligrams per kilogram of cefdazine in the muscle, and then necrotic end fell off, didn't it?
Mm.
And we're waiting for regrowth. And you're bathing with...
Warm water, yeah. It's got to be warm, lukewarm water.
Ovidine, iodine.
I thought you meant bathing him for his thingy.
Oh, yeah, no,
not about the tail.
Bathing tail with... Ovidine, iodine. Yeah.
Which Kate said to water down until it turns orange.
Yeah, good.
Which I've done.
Yeah, it's pretty strong stuff. Yeah. So there's only rough notes. I could do better notes if you like, but it's all here.
Yeah.
Necrotic end of the tail, x-ray to check no infection, going up the tail, swab taken, discharge around the tail,
rise from Richard Hazard of Plymouth Vet Hospital, injected with ceftazidine in muscle. His crotch again fell off and waiting for it to regrow, and you're bathing with povidone iodine.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I'll do that every day until I come back here in 2 weeks, yeah?
Yes, as long, yes.
Right.
Yeah.
I'll keep doing that
then. Okay.
That's brilliant.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is actually a cautionary tale, both from a humanitarian point of view and, believe it or not, from a cryptozoological one, because many people do tend to get hold of pets that they have no idea how to look after and are totally unequipped to deal with. Sadly, we all know what happens all too often. They let them go, which in the UK condemns any tropical animal to a slow and unpleasant death. They'll last for a few months over the summer, but as soon as the autumn arrives, with the season of mists and mellow fruitfulness, the animal will slowly succumb and die. In some countries, this has become a serious ecological problem. In Florida, for example, animals like iguanas and Burmese pythons have become established in the Everglades, where they are taking their toll on the native wildlife. Some people think that the only way to make sure that things like this don't happen is to ban the import and keeping of exotic pets. But we believe that not only are exotic pets very useful for people to learn about the natural world, but to do this would be completely unfair on the vast majority of people who keep such animals, who are responsible and caring, kind and humane pet keepers. No, I'm afraid, as Charlotte says, there's only one real answer.
Do your research and don't buy an animal that you don't know how to look after.
This has been a party political broadcast on behalf of the Charlotte Party. And like all the CFZ girls, she sure knows how to party.
You gotta fight for your right to party!
And now it's time to go over to my lovely wife Karina and our regular monthly visit to the Watcher of the Skies.
I have always felt a curious affinity with this species of bird, probably because for 30 years I was a secretary, and this is a secretary bird, a highly specialised ground-dwelling bird of prey from an older family than the other Old World raptors. It is native to sub-Saharan Africa and is sadly non-migratory, so will never be a natural visitor to these shores. But I think you'd be surprised quite how many completely unexpected avian visitors Britain does have, and that's what this segment On the Track is all about. Bernard Heuvelmans himself said that cryptozoology wasn't the study of monsters, but the study of unexpected animals. And in the UK, what could be more unexpected than vultures, spoonbills and albatrosses? Yes, even the kings of the Southern Ocean have been seen in British waters. Two species of albatross have been recorded in the UK in recent years. Not all of our feathered visitors are quite so spectacular, but nearly every day there is something exciting to greet the Watcher of the Skies.
During the 11th of March, a great spotted cuckoo was found at Gilter Point, south of Penally in Pembrokeshire. It is the first British record since 2009, when one was found in Norfolk. In all, there are 56 accepted British and Irish records of great spotted cuckoo, highlighting that, despite being a relatively regular vagrant, it remains very rare. It is widespread on migration and travels southeast and southwest Europe and Western Asia, wintering in Africa. A brood parasite, it lays its eggs in the nests of corvids, especially magpies and starlings. It feeds on insects, spiders, small reptiles and hairy caterpillars, the last which are distasteful to many other birds being a speciality. Yum! Its habitat is woodland or savanna. Ah, the young pretender has left. Between the 14th and 15th of March, a female house finch was spotted in a private garden in Tunbridge Wells, Kent. The house finch was originally from the western United States, Mexico, and in 1940 a small number were turned loose on Long Island in New York, which then began rapidly breeding and spreading across most of the eastern United States and southern Canada. The red of a male house finch comes from pigments contained in its food during molt, so the more pigment in the food, the redder the male. This is why people sometimes see orange or yellowish male house finches, but the females prefer to mate with the reddest male they can find. They live in human-created habitats, including buildings and urban centres. but in their native range they occupy natural habitats including dry desert, desert grassland, etc. They feed almost exclusively on plant materials. On Saturday the 29th of March, a drake Bacal teal was seen at Fen Drayton in Cambridgeshire. It is also known as the bimaculate or squawk duck and is a dabbler which breeds in eastern Russia on tundra edge and in swampy forests, wintering in East Asia on lowland fresh waters. During winter it is occasionally seen in Taiwan and Hong Kong, with vagrants reaching as far west as the Iberian Peninsula and east to the United States in Alaska and California. It feeds mainly on seeds and grain, as well as water snails, algae and various other water plants. At the beginning of the month, female king eiders were still off Black Sod in Mayo, Cathamore in Cork, Ruddens Point in Fife and Yellow Craig in Lothian. This bird is a rare vagrant to our shores and was first recorded in 1832. The king eider breeds in Arctic Eurasia and North America and winters south to North Europe and central United States. It lives on tundra ponds and lakes. The female king eider does not feed very often during the 22 to 24 day incubation period. The king eider forages on seabeds up to 25 metres or 82 feet if you're old fashioned like me. It feeds on aquatic insects, larvae, crustaceans and plant matter in the summer, and during winter feeds on a wide variety of marine animals including mollusks, crustaceans and echinoderms, as well as algae. And that is it for this month, and now it's over to Jonathan for the regular look at new and rediscovered species. Bye bye!
Strangely strange, but oddly normal.
20 students following a course on tropical biodiversity organised by Naturalis Biodiversity Centre in the Netherlands and held in the Dana Gerang Field Centre in Sabah, Malaysian Borneo, have discovered a new species of spider. These 1 millimetre long spiders built tiny webs that they suspend between dead leaves on the forest floor. When they started putting our nose to the ground, we saw them everywhere, said Danish student Jenny Burmeister enthusiastically. The students then decided to make the official naming and description of the species a course project. They rigged the field centre's microscopes with smartphones to produce images of the tiny spiders' even tinier genitals, using cooking oil from the station's kitchen to make them more translucent. They dusted the spiders' webs with puffs of corn flour, also from the kitchen, to make them stand out and describe the way they were built. They also put a spider in alcohol as a holotype. This holotype specimen is to be kept in the collection of University of Malaysia, Sabah. Finally, a dinnertime discussion yielded a name for this latest addition to the Tree of Life, Crasignatha danaugirensis, after the field studies centre's idyllic setting at the Danaugirang Oxbow Lake. The Roosevelt's muntjac was first discovered in 1929 and was not seen alive again until earlier this year. Roosevelt's barking deer, or Roosevelt's muntjac, was first discovered in 1929 by the sons of President Theodore Roosevelt, Theodore Jr. and Kermit Roosevelt in Laos. After that, this animal had never been seen anywhere in the world alive until a camera trap in Vietnam photographed two of the deer deep in the forest, 85 years after its last sighting. It may look like an alien, but this is a newly discovered four-eyed fish which is baffling scientists after being found in the waters off Australia. With its 360-degree vision, the glass-head barrel eye has evolved with extra eyes to help detect prey, potential mates and predators. It was found by excited researchers at the University of Tübingen's Institute of Anatomy in Germany after an expedition in the Tasman Sea between Australia and New Zealand. Named Rhycholynchias natalensis, it lives at depths of between 800 and 1,000 metres, that's 2,600 and 3,300 feet. It has two primary cylindrical eyes pointing upwards so it can see prey or predators silhouetted against the gloomy light above, as well as a second set of silvery ones on the side of its head. It is said that this fish can grow up to a length of 16 centimetres.
A Malaysian Dutch team of biologists have catalogued all 31 species of the tiny but very pretty snail genus Plectosoma from West Malaysia to Sumatra and Thailand. 10 species are new to science, but some of them are going extinct just as they're being discovered. The study was carried out by PhD student Bo Seng Liu of Naturalis Biodiversity Centre in Leiden, the Netherlands, and three colleagues. Liu, who's on study leave, spent 4 years studying the distribution, shell shape, and genetics of these minuscule snails. He's still working on the species from Borneo, where Plectosoma is especially diverse. But in the new species, published in the open access journal ZooKeys, he first gets the species from the rest of Asia out of the way. These snails are special for several reasons, says Liu. First of all, they flaunt all shell coiling rules by having very irregularly coiled and ornamented shells, making them look like micro-jewellery. Liu used a so-called micro-CT scanner, which produces three-dimensional x-rays of very tiny objects to investigate the exact shapes of the shells. This allowed him to recognise 31 species. Another peculiarity is they only live on limestone hills. In Southeast Asia, such hills are usually few and far between, and the snails that manage to colonise them are completely isolated. This, in turn, has caused a lot of endemism, and many Plectosoma species only occur on a single hill and nowhere else on Earth. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this episode. I have to apologise for being so late this month. This is mostly because I've not been very well. As you probably can see, I'm not very well at the moment either. But like the Pony Express, we always get there in the end. I'd like to say a big thank you to Charlotte for her co-presenting this time. I think you'll agree with me, she has a great future ahead of her. I'd also like to say a big thank you to Saskia England and her brother Riley. Saskia is, as I'm sure you know, one of our two interns, and Riley, her younger brother, has started coming along to get more experience about working with animals. Guys, I don't know what I'd be able to do without you. I'd also like to say a big thank you to your mum, Karen, for letting her two kids come along here and for being such a star all round. I'd like to say a big thank you to our other intern, Sherry Myler, who in early April came down here for a week. And I'd like to say a big thank you to Helen Taylor, and especially to the staff at Pembode Veterinary Practice in Bradworthy for allowing us to film the work they did on Helen's injured iguana. I'd also like to say a big thank you to Andrew Ryder, to Graham Inglis, and to my lovely wife Karina, who once again is filming this. And Karina, my love, I know I'm a pain in the neck at times, but I couldn't do any of the stuff I do without you, and thank you so much. You're the reason I get out of bed in the mornings. We've got a big year ahead of us. We have the 15th Weird Weekend and an exciting schedule of publishing coming up, and there will soon be news of expeditions. So all I will say to you is there's lots of exciting things coming up, and until next month, be seeing you.
The sun was shining, but when I looked up, by hush neon I was struck. Must adjust my sense of timing. Must be just my sense of timing. Pieces to the jigsaw.